हेलो नमस्कार खंबागनी पीपल, वेलकम बैक टू आवर चैनल प्रोफेसर तिवारी एंड माय नेम इज अमृता। सो टुडे वी गोना कंटिन्यू विद द सेम टॉपिक ऑफ क्लास 11, दैट इज सेल द यूनिट ऑफ लाइफ, बट विल मूव फॉरवर्ड इन दैट एंड विल स्टडी अबाउट द यूकैरियोटिक सेल्स। सो यस्टरडे वी जस्ट डिस्कस अबाउट द प्रोकैरियोटिक सेल्स, सो टुडे वी गोना डिस्कस द यूकैरियोटिक सेल्स। फॉर मोर डिटेल्ड इंफॉर्मेशन और फॉर लाइक डिटेल्ड differentiation between the prokaryotic and eukaryotic organisms, like I've already repeated in my previous videos too, that you can get it from the class 9th playlist, you can get it over there. So here we're gonna go for the advanced level, and the class 9th what was the basic level. Okay, so we'll go with the eukaryotic cells. Okay, like what is the major difference, or what are the things, or what organisms lies under the category of eukaryotic cells? If you just look at the eukaryotic cells, then we have the organisms that lie under the eukaryotic cells are animals, all animals, okay, plants, fungi, and protists, okay. So these are the organisms which lie under the category of the eukaryotic cells, which means animals, plants, fungi, and protists are those organisms or those categories of the organisms that fall under the eukaryotic cells. Okay, now moving ahead in the eukaryotic cells, like we have already seen, like if you might have studied in your class 9th also, that the eukaryotic cells are those organisms that actually have the membrane bound structures. Okay, so if you just look at the eukaryotic cells, then you will find the membrane bound structures. Okay, they have membrane bound structures, or you can say organelles. Okay, so in the cytoplasm of the eukaryotic cells, you will find compartmentalization, which means you will find each and every organ present, different small organs or organelles or structures, cell structures present inside the cell in the cytoplasm. Okay, so all these structures are present in the cytoplasm. Like for example, if I just give the name of the few of them, like the ER, endoplasmic reticulum, we can call it Golgi bodies, or Golgi apparatus you can call it. Okay, mitochondria fall under this category. Okay, what else? Plastids, if you just go beyond that. Okay, other than that, you have the centrioles, and like if I just call it more than vacuoles. Okay, all these structures are actually the membrane bound structures, which means they have extra covering present on them. If you just look at any of these structures, if I just talk about the mitochondria, then if you just look at the structure of mitochondria, then this is the structure of mitochondria, and it is like this. Okay, so mitochondria is actually a double layer structure, which means it has two membranes, like one is this one, the outer one, and the inner one. Okay, so this is the membrane bound structures that we were talking about. Other than these membrane bound structures, eukaryotic cells also have certain non membrane bound structures, which are the which is the ribosomes that we have discussed, like when we were discussing the introductory part of the this chapter, and also we also discussed about the centrioles. So centrioles are also the they are not the membrane bound structures. Okay, now as we have just seen that animals, plants, fungi, and protists are the part of membrane bound, they are the eukaryotic cells, but not like if you just talk about on the greater view, then we talk about animals and plants, then animal and plants definitely they are the eukaryotic cells, but still they don't actually have the same kind of organelles, which means they still have certain different organelles. If you just look about the animals, then what other things that animals have but the plants don't have is the centrioles. Okay, so centrioles is actually not present in plant cells. It might be present in certain plant cells, but it is not present in all the plant cells, but it is you can definitely find it, this one, in the animal cells. Okay, whereas the plant, if you just look at the plant cells or the cells of the plants, then definitely you can see the in plants you will find the vacuoles, central vacuole that you call it, and it is a permanent vacuole. Other than that, you have the plastids, which is present only in the plants. Okay, other than that you have or you also have a chloroplast which has been there. All right, so these are the few differences that we have, that we actually have between the in the eukaryotic cells that exist. Okay, now other than that, what the plant also have, the very different characteristic that plant has is the cell wall. All the animals, they lack cell wall, but yeah, bacteria has a cell wall, but it does not fall into the category of eukaryotic cells. It is a prokaryotic cell. So you can definitely, bacteria is not a prokaryote, so we don't count it. Bacteria is not a eukaryotic, so definitely we will not count it over there. But yeah, animals don't have the cell wall. Only plants have the cell wall. We have discussed like what is the role of a cell wall. So cell wall is actually provides a strength to the plant. Okay, it provides a strength to the plant. Other than that, it also provides a structure to the plant, and it helps the plant from not getting collapsed or burst. Okay, or it also protects the plant from the external harsh environment. I have discussed all these things in detail in the class 9th video. If you can just check out the playlist over there, you can easily find it out. Now, moving ahead in the eukaryotic cells, now we'll discuss more about the internal structures that we have just said it, like the internal structure, which has been the first one that I would like to discuss over here, is your cell membrane or plasma membrane. Why we are discussing the first one, the cell membrane or the plasma membrane over here, the first as a first feature or the first characteristic of a eukaryotic cell, is because it is the first one that you see when you try to enter inside the cell. Okay, now like if you go on to the basics, then you can go for the class 9th one, but we will just discuss a bit of the basics over here. So if you just look at the structure of plasma membrane, so what the plasma membrane do? It actually, if you just look at the characteristics of plasma membrane, then it separates cell from its outer environment. Okay, this is the major part that the cell wall or the cell membrane or the plasma membrane performs, that it separates the cell from its outer environment, which means all the organelles which are present inside the cell, they need to be protected from the outside environment, because might be the pH level or might be some other conditions which is required for the survival of the cell organelles or cell structures, or this for or is being required for the cell organs, might not be adequate outside. Okay, so might be there are some harsh environment outside, then the inside some other nutrients that the cell these cell organelles require, so they're not present outside. It's actually the cell membrane acts as a barrier between the outside environment and between the inside environment. Okay, other than that, what is the other feature of the cell membrane is that it is semi-permeable or selectively permeable. Okay, when I say semi-permeable or selectively permeable, which means that only certain molecules or certain things will be allowed to move outside or inside the cell. Okay, lot many things depend, we'll just discuss like how they are being moved. Okay, like we have discussed this thing in the class 9 chapters 2, but we'll discuss like how they are being done. So they only allow certain materials to go inside the cell and outside the cell, so that the concentration of the cell remains intact, and it also helps the cell organelles to not to move out. Otherwise, what will happen if suppose cell membrane allows everything to go inside and everything to come outside, then it might possible that the cytoplasm can move inside, which contains lot of nutrients, which is very much required for the survival of the cell. Other than that, even the organelles can might start moving. There are some other proteins which are being there required for the development of the cell. It can also start moving. There might be some other materials which are outside, which might be toxic for the cell, can move inside, like certain gases, or might be urea, or might be even the blood can flow inside the cell. Okay, so it is not, so it should not happen like that. So this is a very important thing over here. Now, if we just look at this structure, like the, as we know that the cell membrane is a selectively permeable or semi-permeable membrane, which means there is a certain composition which works or which is been there so that it can actually help the cell membrane to be a selectively permeable or semi-permeable. So if you just look at this structure of the cell membrane, the most you can say accepted one the most accepted cell membrane structure was actually given by the two scientists whose name were Singer and Nicholson in the year 1972. Okay, so in the year 1972, two scientists who were there, Singer and Nicholson, they actually gave a very promised or prominent cell structure, which we called as, today we called as, which we called as fluid mosaic model. Okay? Alright, fluid mosaic model has been there, which was actually been given by the Singer and Nicholson. So if you just look at this structure, see initially what happened is that because the structure of the cell membrane, you can say the structure of the cell membrane was actually, or even the internal structure of the cell was actually not that much defined or not that much, you can say, visible or being understood until and unless year 1950. What happened in 1950? A very high configuration, okay, a microscope with a very high configuration, very high features came into existence, and that was electron microscope. Okay, two type of microscopes were there, TEM, okay, transmission electron microscope, and SEM was there, scattering electron microscope. Though TEM is being widely used to see the outer structure or to the cell membrane of the, to see the exact structure of the cell membrane, that was by the TEM. And the electron microscope actually came into existence in 1950. Before 1950 or till 1950, through the study of, like, through the chemical study, okay, by chemical studies we could only able to give structure of RBC, red blood corpuscles membrane. Okay, so there are several chemical studies that took place, chemical studies like the, by the biochemical studies took place, with the help of which we could able to understand the structure of RBC, like how the, what can be the nature of, what is the nature of the RBC, what is the nature of the RBC's membrane. Okay, so that was still like the chemical studies was being there. So now when the more biochemical studies and with the emerge, with the like when the electron microscope came into existence, other biochemical studies took place. Okay, so according to those biochemical studies, it was being studied that the cell membrane is actually being made up of lipids. Okay, it was being made up of lipids. It was being said that according to biochemical studies, the cell membrane is made up of lipids. When more of the studies being done, it was actually been said that it has more other components or more chemicals are present on them, biochemical chemicals are present on them, which is the proteins and carbohydrates. Okay, so according to the whatever the study has been done, that is what is the fluid mosaic model as actually described, or the fluid mosaic model actually based upon the biochemical studies and the electron microscope studies, it actually shown that the lipid, that the cell membrane is actually made up of three things, that is the lipids, the proteins and the carbohydrates. So three things are being there. Okay, now how these three things actually form the whole cell membrane, we'll just look at, to look into that. But a very important point over here is that, as I said, that the cell membrane is made up of lipids, proteins and your carbohydrates, but it is not necessary that all the cell types present in your body, which means the nerve cell, your muscle cell, might be your or some other cell which has been there, they will gonna have the same composition of all of these materials or of these chemicals, biochemicals. Like for example, if I just give you an example of over here, then human RBC. Human RBC actually has 52% protein and 40% of lipids present on them. Okay, so human RBC or membrane of the human RBC has 52% of protein and 40% of lipid. This is just one example, but the composition varies according to the cells. Okay, this, the composition of these materials varies. All right. Now moving ahead into this one, like as I told you that we have the structure of the cell membrane. So we need to understand the structure of cell membrane. I just make the cell membrane structure over here for you. So I'll just make it over here. So the cell membrane structure is somewhat like this. Okay, I'm using some colors over here so that you can understand. Okay, all right. Now few more things over here that we need to add. Okay, I'll make few more things over here. I'll discuss what these things are. Okay, all right. Now I have to make one more thing. I think I'll make with this one only, just to I'll make sure that what I'll just mark them up what they are actually. Okay, now if you just look at the whole structure of this is the structure of your plasma membrane or of your cell membrane. Now we just look at the structure. So this is your this one and this one, they are this is the lipid layer. This is the lipid layer. These both are the lipid layer, the one outside, okay, and one this one. So this is the lipid layer, this is how it works. Okay, now what are these? This one and this one, these are proteins. I'm just writing that short form for the proteins. This is the protein that we have. Okay, what this green one is, this one which is present on this protein, this one is actually, this is also a protein. Okay, just don't get confused, these all are proteins, the red ones which are marked, the spiral ones. This is your sugar or carbs. Okay, what about these ones which are present inside the plasma membrane? This is your cholesterol. Okay, this is a cholesterol. Now if you just look at this structure, you can see that we have two layers of the plasma membrane, we have two layers of lipids. So actually we call the lipid layer, this whole lipid layer, as phosphate bilayer, bilipid layer. Okay, this whole layer has been called as phosphate bilipid layer. Why we call it phosphate bilipid layer is because these tails, see, it actually has two things. This is the head of your membrane. Okay, and these black ones, this is the tail. Okay, if you just look at the head is actually polar in nature. Okay, which means they are hydrophilic, which means water liking. They like water. These heads like water. Whereas the tail, if you just look at the tail, then tail actually is non-polar in nature, which means it is hydrophobic, which means water hating. Okay, this tail is actually being made up of, if I just talk about the tail, then this tail is actually being made up of saturated hydrocarbons. This tail is being made up of saturated hydrocarbons and we call it phosphoglycerides. Okay, it is being called as phosphoglycerides. These are being made up of phosphoglycerides. See, what happens is because the heads, they are water loving, so they can remain outside. Okay, because outside the cell the water is being present everywhere, so they can easily survive outside that. But the tail, which is actually water heating, it is hydrophilic in nature, so it is non-polar in nature. So it is inside, it is present inside the cell. Okay. Other than that, we have the proteins present on it. If you can just look at the proteins, some of the proteins you can see they are present like outside, whereas this protein is going inside. Okay. Now, if you just talk about the proteins, the existence of the proteins, then we have the proteins. We have two types of proteinous structure in the lipid membrane, and which is the peripheral protein and integral protein. Okay, the peripheral protein will be that protein present on the lipid bilayer, phospholipid bilayer, is that it will be present on the periphery, which will be present on the surface like this. This is the cell surface, this is the surface, and this will be present like this. So the proteins which is present like this on the surface of the cell membrane or the plasma membrane will be called as peripheral protein, present on the periphery, where the integral proteins are will be those proteins which will be either like this, which means it is half inside the plasma membrane, half outside, just like this one, or there can be chance that certain protein can might like this. This is also an integral protein, which means they will be either like this, okay, or they will be completely like this between the two plasma membrane. Okay, so those are the integral proteins. All right, now as we have seen, like we have seen, like what is the structure was been there. Okay, now moving ahead into whole of this thing is that the plasma membrane is actually fluid in nature. When I say fluid in nature, or this is actually quasi fluid model, it has been there. Okay, and it helps in fluidity. When I say it helps in fluidity, which means the materials can flow through them. Okay, or you can say the protein basically. Okay, like if I say, then we have this whole plasma membrane is actually quasi fluid model. When I say quasi fluid model, which means that proteins can easily move in plasma membrane, which means it is not like that. As a protein has been like this, it will remain like this for its whole of its life, because this is your cell. So this protein can move like this. This can move like this. Okay, it can move completely like this on the plasma membrane. Okay, it will move like this. So that is what is being called. So which means, because of this reason that protein can easily move in the plasma membrane, this whole thing, this is called as fluidity. Now how this fluidity helps in, this fluidity actually helps in the plasma membrane, actually helps in many things. Okay, like it can help in cell division, it can help in endocytosis, it can help in formation of intracellular junctions. Okay, it can also help in secretion. Okay, all right, etc. So there are many things. Because of this fluidity, the cell membrane becomes like, it can help in cell division, endocytosis, and formation of intracellular junctions, and cell and secretion, and many other things, because it can perform through the fluidity. Okay, when I say fluidity, which means the protein can move in the plasma membrane like this. As I told you, suppose this is the plasma membrane and this is protein is being like this. So it can move like this, and then it can move like this, and then it can completely move like this completely again. So it can move like this in the plasma membrane. The protein can move. Okay, but when I say it can move, which doesn't mean that it will allow everything. That first thing we discussed about, of the first thing that we learned about the plasma membrane, is that plasma membrane does not, it is a semi-permeable or selectively permeable membrane, which means it will only allow certain materials to go through it. Okay, if you just look at it, which means it can briefly allow movement of certain materials. It can briefly allow movement of certain materials, and it is because of the, and this is the passive transport. Okay, all right. Certain materials can passively can move through it, and it is up to the passive transport, which means it can move easily. Okay, but there are certain materials like the neutral materials. Okay, because that is, I told you that this is the polar head, but this is the non-polar area, which means they will not gonna open for everything that is coming through it. Okay, neither from inside, neither not from outside. So which means if it is allowing certain materials, briefly allowing certain materials to move inside and outside the cell, which will be through the passive transport, which means there will be no use of energy. When we say passive transport, there will be no use of energy and the materials can easily move through it. Neutral materials can move through it. Materials can move through simple diffusion. Simple diffusion. Okay, now how does simple diffusion work? Simple diffusion actually works through concentration gradient. We have discussed this concentration gradient in the class 9 videos. You can go ahead. I just write for the short form, from higher to lower concentration. Okay, so it can easily move from higher concentration to lower concentration. Same goes for the water. Water can also move through diffusion. Okay, water can also move through diffusion, but the term will be used over here is osmosis. Okay, but as I told you that the passive transport has been there, simple diffusion is there, osmosis is there. One very last thing is which is remaining over here is that, what about the materials which need to move against the concentration gradient? Because there will be many things will be there which can't move according to the concentration gradient, which means they have to move from against the concentration gradient, which means lower to higher concentration. Okay, so the last thing over here is, if the materials has to move from lower to higher concentration, if suppose, okay, then they have to use energy. This energy will be provided by the ATP. Okay, and this whole procedure will be called as active transport. Okay, now example, if I had to give you over here is sodium potassium pump. All right, so if the materials has to move against the concentration gradient, that is from lower to higher concentration, they have to use certain amount of energy. That energy will be provided by the ATP, and this whole procedure where the ATP is being required for the movement of certain materials in opposite of the concentration gradient, the transport will be called as active transport, and one of the example is sodium potassium pump. This is all for today. Like we have discussed about the cell membrane, and we discussed the fluid mosaic model given by the Singer and Nicholson in the year 1972. So in the next class, we'll discuss more about the different cell organelles. We'll go inside the cell, we'll discuss more about it. So that's all for today, and I'll see you in the next class. If you have any doubts, comments, and suggestions, please drop them in the comment box below. And please like, share, subscribe our channel, and don't forget to hit the bell icon. Thank you. Bye.